everyone. Welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is a show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Shardé Sellers. On today's episode, we have an interview with the screenwriters of tech dramedy Blackberry, Matt Johnson and Matthew Miller. Matt, Matthew, and I chat about adapting a book to a screenplay, finding the humor in drama, and of course, Blackberries. Check it out. Welcome to Write On, everyone. It is Shardé again, and happy holidays. I'm so excited to be talking to these next two creators from their new movie, Blackberry, that I got to watch last night, admittedly on edibles, so it made it 10 times better. Just kidding. But as a previous Blackberry user, I've got to say, I learned so much watching this film. So to break the ice, my first question, I want to give it to you, Miller, is did you ever own a Blackberry?
I did. I owned a Blackberry sort of around 2010, which is after the period that the bubble burst, or right around that time. And I used them for a couple of years. I loved them. I produced my first movies on them, like my first features. Loved the keypad. But then, you know, and I remember getting my first iPhone and being like, this sucks. And then a week later, that's all I wanted to use. And then in making the film, and you started to play around with the old Blackberries, like on set and stuff. And I used to be so fast, and either my thumbs have gotten fatter, or I'm just out of practice. But I decided that I didn't like the product now as much as I did back in the day. And I think it's better that we've all given our money to Apple now.
My mother used to have a Blackberry, and I thought she was so professional. Anyone carrying a Blackberry was just like, to me, just suit and tie business person. I was like, wow, they've got their life together. They've got a Blackberry. Johnson, did you ever own a Blackberry?
No, the first time I ever held one in my life was on set.
Oh my gosh, really? Why?
I think I was too young and just kind of missed the dawn of the smartphone revolution. And I wasn't interested in them, but I had an iPhone and I thought that was awesome. But it was, I never, ever, ever owned a BlackBerry. I knew about BBM because I would hear about it all the time, but it was a complete black box to me. I didn't even understand how they worked. Most of the writing of this film was me learning like the basics of what the product actually did. And I found that so interesting because I knew nothing about it.
Wait, I really love this dynamic. So Miller, you've had experience with the BlackBerry, and Johnson, you haven't. So coming together to write this film, I'll ask this question to you, Miller. What were the conversations like in building the script, having to teach Johnson about this product that he's actually never held before?
Yeah, well, you know, it's funny because we're sort of in this wave of like product movies, but we never thought of this as a product movie. Like us talking about the BlackBerry, how it works, networks, all like the engineering of the product. Like, I would say we really didn't talk about that until years into the writing process, because we really started by thinking about these three main guys, specifically Mike and Jim, and trying to understand what drove them, what motivated them, what the dynamic was between them, and what we could dramatize through exploring that. And so we talked a lot more about that early on, as opposed to me being like, oh, you know, what was cool is the way you can move the cursor here. You do a double space and a period comes up or whatever, you know. But then we did obviously want to learn about those things as we started to pepper in some more of the details into some of the scenes that we were constructing.
And then for you, Johnson, you're pulling triple duty on this project. Is that correct?
At least.
I'm acting and writing and directing in it, but that job really doesn't have as much of a delineation as I think many people think.
Well, what do you mean by that?
Like, there's a big divide between writing a film and then being on set. But once you're on set and you're the director, in some ways you are the de facto writer, because you're making final calls on what people are going to say and how they're going to say them and what the tone is going to be, and you're changing things on the fly. And so those two jobs really do meld into one another. And then when you're acting in a movie, I'm used to directing from in front of the camera. I'm much more comfortable doing that. And so I never thought of these jobs as very distinct.
I want to ask this question to both of you, but I'll go to Miller first. How do you support your writing partner knowing that they are going to be doing triple duty on this project once it goes into production?
Well, I thought about that a lot more as a producer of the film as opposed to the writer of the film. Like, that's something I'm constantly trying to do. This was the biggest movie we'd made before in terms of the scope and the budget size and the cast. And we were trying to sort of bring some of the elements that we brought to our earlier films and the free flow of ideas and collaboration and the way we liked to work and improvisation and try that in this larger framework. And that was kind of the big challenge that we gave ourselves with this film. And so again, as the producer of the project, I was mindful of that and trying to think of what decisions could we be making to sort of insulate what we have so that we don't lose sort of that magic that I think we try to capture in our work. But I don't know that I did much as a writer to try to, you know, other than that, you know, like I know Matt is a performer well, so we could talk about those scenes and sort of be like, oh, it would be funny if you did this or whatever, right? Yeah. I don't know if you have any examples, Jocelyn, or what you think about that.
Of writing something specifically in terms of ease of use. Well, it's funny when you're writing a movie, knowing that you're also going to make the movie. Miller didn't really talk about this, but we were writing the script knowing that we were going to have to produce these images. And so we were very specific about where scenes would be taking place, about knowing what we'd be able to get in Toronto, like where we'd actually be able to shoot. Like,
well, and because we were also producers, it was like writing to budget, right?
Like, exactly. That's my point.
You know, not wanting to censor yourself in the moment, but also being realistic, you know, kind of knowing these are our resources and how could we use them wisely.
I think pragmatic screenwriting is one of the great secrets to success for anybody starting in the business, anybody young, anybody who is trying to make something that they actually want to get sold or they actually want to make. Being pragmatic about it, although it may seem almost hacky in a way, and in some ways it is, you realize that being inside that box, which is the what is actually producible for the lowest budget possible, that box is an unbelievably powerful restriction because it helps you to limit your vision, but in a creative way where it's like, oh shit, I need a bunch of scenes in boardrooms that I can use for multiple boardrooms. Like, how can I use that to my advantage? And in some ways, the structure of the movie as it stands came from needing to reuse the same locations over and over again. And so if you'll notice, the film takes place almost in the same engineering room, and we keep leaving it, then coming back, leaving it, then coming back. And it's also no surprise that their main customer is at first Bell Atlantic and then Verizon, which Bell Atlantic became. And they visit them twice. They keep going back to Saul Rubinek playing the head of Verizon. And of course, that's not like BlackBerry had tons of clients and they sold their phone to tons of people. But the restriction of, okay, we don't want to have a whole bunch of different actors playing this role. We don't want to have a whole bunch of different environments. So how can we use this restriction as a strength? And what that meant was, oh, we can have Verizon stand in for all of these big telcos. And that means the audience is going to form a kind of relationship with Saul Rubinek as a performer because they keep seeing him. And it's going to make the film way easier to make, but also narratively much clearer. And that decluttering of story that happened because we were forced to assimilate multiple characters into one, multiple locations into one, so that shooting the film would be practical, winds up being a massive story assist for the audience. Because now, rather than needing to keep track of, you know, 14 different B plots, they're all condensed into one. So again, I think people think of writing to a budget or writing to a small scale as, well, why shouldn't I just write whatever comes to my mind? Like, shouldn't I just go as big and as crazy as possible? And that's kind of poisonous advice that actually will stop you in your tracks, both in terms of the producibility of your work, but also you leave behind all these great career before you.
I want to ask Miller, because Johnson, that's such a great answer. That's actually the first time I've had anyone say that specifically. Most of the time you're right. The advice is like, just write it and don't think about it. And I know for younger indie writers who are listening to this, that's not always possible. So Miller, what is the balance between, okay, we know creatively we really want this to happen, but we also know we've got to stick to this budget. Like, what wins at the end of the day on the page? Is it the story or the budget?
Well, look, we've always prioritized creative and we want to figure out what we want to do, look at our resources and then say, well, how are we going to do this? What's the best way to do this with what we have? And, you know, I don't think, Johnson, correct me if I'm wrong, like, I don't think we made any concessions, like, from the script to production, or being like, we can't do this because it's too expensive, or because, and again.
But that's because we made the concessions in the writing.
In the writing. But even now, in hindsight, it's not like, you know, there are not things we didn't get to do that I'm like, oh, we would have really loved to have done that. Mm-hmm. And often the concessions you make because of budget, like, and I think that's what Joss was getting at before, but like, they help story or they help character because it forces you to be more resourceful or be sort of made Saul this stand-in for all of these CEOs in the US that they were going to. It was like, oh, every time we'd go back, we'd get to reveal a little bit more of Saul or play with the dynamic between Saul and Glenn's character a little bit more because they were developing a bit of rapport, right? Whereas if that was somebody different each time, we wouldn't have had that. So yeah, I mean, look, you have to prioritize the creative because otherwise, what are we doing? But if you're one of these people that is so steadfast in your way and being like, no, it must be this way, we can't do it any other way, and you spend 5 years trying to get that movie financed and you can't get it financed, you're the problem. Right. Yeah. Like you need to say, well, I could do without these scenes or whatever. Like, are you going to make a concession or are you not going to make the movie? Because those are your two choices.
It seems also like that aphorism of kill your darlings, which I think everybody knows. And I think they know that concept as it pertains to editing. Often it's like so many times you'll hear about directors or established directors or new directors it being in the edit room, having a scene that they spent a lot of money and a lot of time on, and recognizing only post hoc that it does not, it's not needed. Mm-hmm. It doesn't quite fit the film that they made. And it's so painful because they're like, oh, but I just, because it looks so good or it has some kind of aesthetic value. And it takes a real maturity to be like, no. It's best for the film to lose this big expensive set piece or what have you. And I think that in some ways that is only half of the story, because what you really want is to be able to kill your darlings at the script stage so that you didn't have to spend that money shooting that set piece in the first place. And so if you can have a very sober, personal analysis of a script, even if it's just an outline, but you know, you can get drunk on the excitement of potential when you have a script. And you're like, oh my God, we're going to do this and we're going to do this and it's going to be amazing. And it is, there's a sort of like ebullience around it where you're like, and everything is going to be great. You have so much optimism. And then you're faced with, well, we only have this many shoot days and our crew's only this big and we can only have this many actors. And what winds up happening so often is that you stretch the resources that you have so thin that the lows of your movie become so low that it seems amateur and horrible. Like, you wind up destroying your film for the sake of these few slightly more expensive things that you wanted to do. Mm-hmm. Whereas what we're always trying to encourage people to do is remove as much as you possibly can at the script and planning stage so that you can be over-resourced for everything. And then hopefully have enough left over that once you have a cut of your movie, you can even go back and reshoot new things, which is something that we build into all of our movies. Blackberry was no different. We went back months later to shoot things to fill in gaps as the story kind of changed in the edit. And it's something that we always, because you never know what you don't know. And you yourself are growing as an individual. I know that when Miller and I finished that script, it was, you know, a few months before we went into production. And then I was rewriting it, I would say daily, because my perspective was changing. I was rewriting it with the actors. And then when we were done, we're then looking at this finished film being like, I think we've grown past a lot of these ideas. I think we now realize a lot of these ideas aren't as good as the best ideas in here. And so we then cut those and figured out ways to fill them in both with the edit and reshoots. So to think of a document as a holy thing that is unexpungible is really amateurish in our opinion, and that you want to have the maturity to go, okay, I don't know everything. My film is not going to be perfect and I'm going to make mistakes when I shoot it. So let's leave enough gas in the tank that I can plug those gaps later and kill as many darlings as you can early so that you have those resources at the end.
Oh my gosh, I really love that answer, because I think a lot of writers listening to this put a lot of pressure, especially when you hear the script is the blueprint, it's the blueprint. And you don't, like you said, you don't realize that the script that you wrote may not even be what is done. You just like, this is my product. This is what I have. So I love that you're allowing people to have grace to know that it is going to grow and change and shrink even through editing. and to not let that pressure them. Now, I have a question for you, Miller, and for both of you, but I'm going to start with you because I'm listening to you guys talk about all of these aspects of putting the script together. And I'm getting anxiety in my little heart because I'm thinking you have to not only know the history of the product, but the people and their relationships. And it's based off a book as well. And so you have to do that. And I want to know, where do you even start on a project like this when you're building a story? There's just so many pieces.
Well, yeah, but you know, on this, the project was brought to us by a producer in Canada, Neve Fichman, and they had the option on the book. And he thought he wanted us to look at it and see if maybe we had a take on it. And because we had the book, like it really was the blueprint for the movie. It has so many of the facts and details that we extrapolated and then sort of, and it has, it's like a very dense book with a ton of facts, and there are technology and business reporters working together to tell the story of Rim. And so frankly, like I had to read it a couple times because the first time, like so much of it just went over my head. And even now, if you ask me to explain how these networks work or whatever, like I wouldn't be able to do a much better job than like how Mike explains in the movie, because that's about as much as that's about as well as I can understand it. But, you know, we did additional research on top of that, especially, for instance, like the sequence about Jim trying to buy an NHL team towards the end of the film. Like the book touches on that, what the book was about. But we knew that that was an exciting, opened the world to us of like sports journalism from the time, just reading articles and news talk radio from the time, just to see. And frankly, remembering a lot about what the Canadian media specifically was saying about Jim at that time. So that like that's, you know, 10 years ago in Canada, that's like front page news every day for 6 months, Jim Balsley trying to buy an NHL team, right?
Yeah.
So we had a relationship to that, but we really did rely on the book quite a bit. It would always be by our side while we were writing, even in the edit and stuff. Sometimes we would, because I think what happens when you are adapting, you know, a true life story or based on real events, like so often we would forget, well, did this happen exactly? Like, is this in the book? That's a question we'd ask each other a lot. Like, was that in the book? Was that in the book? Or is that just part of this chronicle that we've created, you know, for this movie? But, you know, we love research. Like our previous film was about the space race and NASA and landed on the moon. And it was like, I remember for that period of time, we felt like the preeminent experts about sort of the Apollo program and NASA and the moon landing in Canada. Because we just spent 3 years learning everything we could about it, seeing all the footage. And like, it's one of the things I love about making movies. You know, you could learn about one thing, make the movie, and then you get to go learn about something else.
Well, Johnson, with that said, with the research mode, how do you know when it's, okay, we're done with research and it's actually time to sit down and write this?
Oh, I think that's a bit of a myth. I don't think you're ever done researching, and my first read of it was pretty perfunctory, and I just kind of gleaned the basic story, but I was going back to that initial book as late as like day 20 of the shoot.
Wow.
And finding new things the characters were making inside the book that I used in dialogue. Let me give you an example. When Saul Rubinek first gets his hands on the prototype of the original BlackBerry in that meeting where Glenn hands it to him in the suitcase, and he takes it out of the case and looks at it, and he laughs in a kind of derisive way and says, well, it definitely is the world's largest pager. And then Mike stops him and goes, actually, it's the world's smallest email terminal. I got that line, I would say, 3 or 4 days before we shot the line verbatim, said by a salesman when they were trying to pitch the original and the rejoinder, both, it's the world's largest pager, it's the world's smallest email terminal. And so I don't think your research is ever done. I'll take it one step further. I've read things now about BlackBerry, now that I'm being inundated by it. I'm sure Miller's the same, where we get people come to us with stories about the company or things that happen. And I'm thinking constantly, I wish I had put that in the film.
Oh,
all the time.
Oh my gosh. Well, but how do you deal with that as a creative when you just rediscovering stuff and you're like, oh, it's too late. The film is done.
How do you deal with that emotionally? Well, look, yes. A film festival premiere, it winds up being the real tape at the end of the race that, you know, once you've crossed, it's done. And Miller and I are notorious for making changes as late as possible, because again, you're always growing and you're always seeing new problems. But at a certain point, you realize that there's no making it perfect. And that's good. That's good. It's nice. Again, I think that both philosophies in the film are correct. Both that perfect is the enemy of good and that good enough is the enemy of humanity. I think that both of those things have a tension that all filmmakers face, which is you do need to at a certain point be like, you know what? It's good enough. I'm going to let it go. But you can't let that happen
too early.
So early. Too early in the process. Yeah. You got to push it.
But that is such a great parallelism to that final scene of the movie where he's fixing the phones. He like just can't stop fixing them. And I kind of imagine you guys in the editing bay or like in the screening room going, let's go back and let's fix that. You know, you're not letting
That's exactly right. You know, I think at the end of the film, we think, oh, this guy's crazy.
Yeah,
right? Like,
yeah.
Really, you think you're going to do this? And again, that's the question you have to, as the creative, as in the edit room, you know, we're always asking ourselves that question, right? Like, are we just being too hard on ourselves? Are we being crazy? Are we too close to this? Right? That's why you go screen it. It's like, oh, let's see what the audience says.
Right.
Right. But yeah, there were a lot of parallels between the story of Rim, specifically the beginning and them coming together and these young guys, you know, trying to change the world above a bagel shop in Waterloo, thinking really that they could, but also not taking themselves very seriously. And, you know, to running a production company, trying to make movies, you know, fresh out of film school with your friends. It was that felt very familiar to us.
Yeah. I mean, like you said before, you don't consider this a tech movie. You see it something more. And I do too. I think it's one of the greatest examples of like taking a risk, taking a swing, even though it may not work out. Cause you're that last text of, you know, they owned what 40% of the market to now zero is so sobering. You're like, oh my gosh, all of that just to end up right back where you started is so painful. Like, but it's life and it happens. I know, I see you shaking your head, Johnson. You're like, oh my God. I want to ask, as we're rounding up our time here, I'll start with you, Johnson, because you guys have some great advice, first of all, advice that I haven't heard on the show ever. What advice do you have for your younger writer self? I'll start with you, Johnson.
Advice for myself?
Yeah.
What would you tell the young screenwriter, Matt Johnson?
Younger, yeah, version of you.
You're so lazy. You're wasting all of your time. I can't believe this. Right. I would say that the world is before you. All you need to do is work. The greatest enemy is yourself. Nobody's trying to stop you. You are by far the biggest impediment to your own development. And you are going to need to sober up and become an adult. And you're completely pathetic.
Oh my gosh. Were you talking to you or me? Because that hit right here in my heart. So that was painful to listen to, but so sobering and needed. Miller,
just
what would your answer be?
To that, I mean, I think all those things are true. The other thing I would tell my younger self is to read more scripts because I don't read a ton of scripts and I wish I had read more and I'm trying to. I watch a lot of movies, but if you want to write, reading what you're trying to write is really helpful tool. I think I would have wanted to read more and just be prepared for a lot of pain and suffering, right? Like it's very hard.
Well, this has been the most optimistic answer ever. Just kidding. No, sometimes you need to hear that. You need to hear the sobering truth. You're lazy. You're not qualified for this. Get to work and start reading more. So hopefully that inspired everyone.
Well, look, I want to be clear. It's not lazy. It's not just laziness. Yeah. Sorry. I was going to say that I think that laziness is one piece of it, that in your life, you are going to be your biggest enemy. Mm-hmm. It's you that you need to overcome, not the world. Like there is nobody out there who is thinking about getting in your way at all more than you are getting in your own way.
Ooh.
And the fact that people are so often, I think, creating narrative in a way to stop them from having their big break or from getting to work or, oh my God, I was going to write today, except then I got a headache. You know, my mom called and annoyed me or I am just too tired or whatever. And they create narratives, which is essentially a kind of therapy for why they aren't where they want to be. And that this is a slow poison that you will slowly die of because you'll wake up and be 35 and have done nothing. And that's when you'll realize, oh my God, I have no one to blame but myself. And you want to realize that when you're 20 and not when you're again, 35, because then it's like, well, yeah, you really got to catch up.
I'm 34.
So you got a year.
I've never felt more called out in my life. I need you on my, like, I need to call you every day. I'm feeling like that. That is me to a T. Oh my gosh. My goodness. Thank you for that advice.
Well, you know, we teach a class together. We teach a class together, Chardé. So we always, you know, we give these pep talks as graduation gifts to our students. So.
And yeah, this felt like a great Christmas present to myself, actually, to hear that sobering. Yeah, right. Because I'm definitely the person that's like, I have a tummy ache. The day is gone. Like,
I don't... Well, look, hey, look, I speak from experience. So don't think that I'm calling out anybody other than myself.
No, I
think it's Stephen King. I think that's his line. The easiest thing for a writer not to do, to not do is write.
Yeah.
Right? The easiest thing for a writer not to do is write.
But I think about it every day. I think about doing it every day, guys.
Yeah, right. Of course. Yeah, the great trap. I'll write it in my head.
I take notes and stuff. Anyway, this is so much fun. I really love talking to you guys. You made such a sensational film. This funny, but also dramatic, and has a great emotional through line about friendship and fear and all the things that I love in movie and storytelling. What's next for you both? I'm assuming you're on like the next one and in research mode because you seem like you never stop. So is that true?
Yeah, we actually just finished shooting a secret film that we shot over the summer and then just recently finished, but that's a very top secret. And then we're in the midst of writing like a few projects right now. One of them is about airports and is involving a lot of research. So it's quite exciting.
Okay.
And one is a series and like a biopic, something probably a little bit closer to Blackberry.
Right, but a famous racer.
Okay. Well, I hope when both of those projects come out, you'll come back on the show so you can—
Oh, we'd love to.
—drag me a little more.
No. Hey, you know what? For your 35th birthday, we'll be there.
That's right. Oh God, the pressure. You know what? That actually, my birthday's in October, so I'll give you a full year to like come back to you and say, look, I did something. I didn't just think about this for another year.
What day in October?
21st.
Okay. I'm October 5th.
Ah, okay. Okay. So you're a fellow Libra. So you get it.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I get it. Yeah.
We're working on it. Johnson, Miller, the Mats, thank you for coming on the show. Stay tuned, everyone. I'll tell you where you can watch Blackberry. And you guys, hold on. I want to say a proper goodbye, but this has been Right On. And happy holidays, everyone. We'll see you next time.
Thanks again to Matt and Matthew for coming on the show. You can watch Blackberry on Amazon Prime now.
And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to our show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Chardé Sellers. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, write on.